Hi everyone, we will continue with functional programming in SML from where we left last time. So basically we stopped at reversing a list. We had described this algorithm in which the reverse of a list is computed recursively. If the list is empty, the base case, then it returns empty. Otherwise, it concatenates the reverse of the tail of the list with the head of the list. Because of the fact that we have the comparison of the list with the empty list, nil, you can basically see that the type that is inferred for the list L is any list that is with comparable elements. So this works exactly as we expect. Basically, if we call reverse of a list like 1, 2, 3, it will call the concatenation of the reverse of the tail, in this case would be the reverse of 2, 3, with the head of the list into a list. So the list that contains 1. And if this executes step by step, reverse is computed and we will get 3, 2, concatenated with 1 gives us the list 3, 2, 1. So this method works. Basically, reverse of a list works. And in fact, if you don't want to use your own concat method that we described earlier in the previous class, you can just use the concatenation of lists operator that is given by SML. This built-in operator works exactly like concat. It iterates from the beginning of the list, takes the head out, and then calls recursively concat for the rest of the first list and the second list. So that same code that we've wrote before, instead of running concat that we basically implemented it before, the concatenation of two lists, just to remind you as how we did it, we said the function concat is defined for a list L1 and L2, and we defined it as if the list L1 was empty or nil, then we return the list L2, else we take the head of L1 and we cons it with concat recursive call with the tail of L1 and L2. So the same method basically has one symbol in SML, which is this at sign. So if you really want to concat two lists, you can just pass in L1 concat L2, and that does basically the same thing. It's just a syntactic sugar that is replaced by this standard definition for concat. So basically this is equivalent, is the same with concat of L1 and L2, whatever L1 and L2 lists are. So the same reverse that we discussed last time can be written with this symbol, which basically gives us exactly the same method, okay? However, if you look at the efficiency of this method, you will see that the time to reverse a list of n elements is equal with the time to concatenate, basically, the result of reversing a list of n minus 1 elements. We take one element out by calling the tail function on the list L with the concatenation of this reverse with the head of the list into a list. So basically, the time to reverse n elements is equal with the time to reverse n minus 1 elements plus the time to execute the concatenation, which is n minus 1, because this concat is left recursive. It basically starts from that list that is the reverse, which has n minus 1 elements, and it takes one element out and calls recursively until we reach the empty list. So we have this recurrence relation that we actually saw before. T of n is equal with T of n minus 1 plus n minus 1. And when you apply again the same recursive formula to n minus 1, you will see that T of n minus 1 is T of n minus 2 plus n minus 2 plus what is left from the first formula, n minus 1. And if you apply it n times after n times steps, you will basically see that you will have the sum of the first n minus one numbers, because you see at the end of this, you have n minus two plus n minus one. And before that, it must be n minus three, n minus four, and so on up to one. So this is equal with one plus two plus three up to n minus one. This sequence has a standard formula, which is n multiplied with n minus one divided by two. So this is On square. So the method is quadratic, it's not linear. And having a reverse that is quadratic is basically not a good reverse. We have to write it in a different way to be more efficient. And the way that I described last time was to use an accumulator. So in that case, you have the function that I described last time, reverse helper, that takes the list and also a partial result. I put it in a list with the label L2. If the first list is empty, then it basically means that in L2, I have the final result. So I return L2. Else I call reverse helper of the tail of the list, and the head of the list cons L2. So basically I take the one element from the beginning of the first argument, and I put it at the beginning of the second argument when I call recursively the next call. So, and reverse of a list L would be a reverse helper of the list L and the empty list. So what happens if you call reverse on the list 1, 2, 3? It basically calls reverse helper of the list 1, 2, 3 and the empty list. Reverse helper will match this call, basically reverse helper of L into L2. And since the list is not empty, it calls reverse helper of the tail, which is 2, 3 out of 1, 2, 3, and puts 1, the head of the list, at the beginning of L2. But 1 cons the empty list is just the list that contains 1. So basically what this method, reverse helper, does, at every step takes the first element of the first argument and puts it as the first element of the second argument. And this goes up to when the first argument becomes the empty list. And then the second argument is returned. So in that case, if L is nil, we return L2. And the result of this reverse helper is basically the result of reverse. So it does the reverse, and we can see that it does it in a linear number of steps with the original call. So if the call had three elements, you have a constant, which is 2 plus, because we had a call for the empty list. So basically, it's a constant plus n, the size of the list, which is O of n. So we basically got a linear time with an accumulator to reverse a list. Now, removing list elements. So we have a list, and we want to remove the first occurrence. So we have a list, and we want to eliminate the first occurrence of the first element, first argument of that function remove. So remove takes two parameters, x, which is the element that we want to remove, and the list L. And it's equal with, if the list L is empty, it returns empty. Else, if x is the head of the list, then it calls remove of x from the tail of the list. So basically, we want to remove x from the rest of the list. If we only wanted to remove the first occurrence, I could have just returned the tail of the list. This removes everything, all occurrences of the first argument from the second argument. Else, since the head of the list was not x, I keep it in the result. So the head of the list cons the result of removing x from the tail of the list. So again, basically what happens, I iterate over the elements. If the element is not equal with the element that I want to remove, if the head of the list is not equal with that, it's kept. And if not, it basically it's deleted. And this is totally done recursively. So it starts from the beginning, and let me actually show you for this call, basically what that method does. So that call will basically return 5 cons, but we still have to resolve the remove of 1 out of the list that contains 3 and 1. And that basically gives me 5 cons. And now since 3 is different than 1, it's 3 cons. And this cons operator is right associative. So it's really like I'm basically creating a list and then cons 5 to it at afterwards. And this calls remove 1 out of the list that contains 1. And this is the same with basically since 1 is the element that needs to be removed, it just calls remove from the tail of X. So basically we call remove 1 from the empty list. And this matches the base case. So it's basically 5 cons, 3 cons, the empty list, because if the list is empty, then we return the empty list. And now on the way back, it creates 5 cons, the list that contains 3, and this is 5, 3. It's basically the result that I wanted after removing every occurrence of 1 in 5, 3, 1, I get 5, 3. Okay. Now, let's say that we want a different function, a function that removes all the duplicates from a list. It doesn't matter where they appear. So for instance, let's look at directly at the example. I want to remove all the duplicates from 3, 2, 4, 6, 4, 3, 2, 3, 5, 4, 2, 1. Basically what I want as a result is a list that contains every element exactly once. So I do not want to have duplicates. 3 appears multiple times, appears here, 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 and here. I want to delete all the duplicates, only keep the first occurrence of the element. So remove duplicates takes a list. If the list is empty, it returns empty. Else, the head of the list is added, first occurrence, cons, the result of removing duplicates from remove the head of the list from the tail of the list. So this is the previous method that we implemented that eliminates the head of the list from the entire tail. It gets the list with all the elements that were there except the elements that are equal with the head of the list. So this basically for every element, it keeps the first occurrence, deletes that element from the rest of the list, and then calls remove duplicates from the rest of the list that doesn't contain that first element. So for every element, we keep the first occurrence and then basically we call remove duplicates on the rest of the elements. Now, in SML, you can define functions in 2 different ways. So one way is to use if statements. Like for instance, we did in all of these examples, basically we have an if statement for concatenation, we had if statements for removal and so on. So instead of writing such a statement using if statements, SML also allows you to define functions via patterns. So the general form of such definitions is function identifier, and then you give what is the expected pattern. And patterns can be empty lists or lists that contain exactly one element, and so on. Basically, a pattern that matches that specific one case. Okay. So, like for instance, I want to write a pattern definition for concat. Okay. So, instead of writing it for any possible list, I can actually write it for a pattern. So, concat of the empty list with the list L2, whatever L2 is just the list L2. And then I can give another pattern. And the second definition is concat of a list that contains a head and a tail with L2 is equal with H cons, the result of concat of the tail T and L2. So you see, it's a shorter definition. I basically, instead of taking any 2 variables And then treating that those variables, if the first list is empty, then return this. Otherwise, take out the head of the list and call concat on the tail of the list and L2. What I'm doing here, I'm basically stating that there are two possibilities for the list L1, the first argument, being empty or being a list that contains at least one head, because h const t, it basically means that there exists a head and some tail afterwards. So there are two possible patterns for this concat function. In the first case, I just return L2, the second argument. In the second case, I do the recursive call. It's h, the head of the first list, const, the result of concat on the tail of the list, and L2. So this is what is called definition by patterns. It basically allows you to write a pattern for all the possible cases. The first case that matches your invocation. So for instance, I had the invocation concat of the list that contains 1, 2, 3 with the list that contains 4, 5, 6. And of course, this does not match the first definition, which is expecting for the first head to be empty, for the first list to be empty. So it matches the second one, and basically it calls, says take the head out, because this was expecting a function with at least one head. Take the head out, do const, and then call concat of the tail of the list. So in this case is the list that contains 2, 3 and the same second list, 4, 5, 6. And again, this works the same way. Basically, the next step is 1, const, 2, const, concat, and so on. Basically, calls concat of 3 and the second list completely. Okay. So that's the whole idea of patterns. Instead of writing if statements, we are trying to match every single pattern of the rule. Like, what are we expecting some argument to be? Okay, so this is exactly what basically happens here. All of these are functional definitions, but the patterns match a certain pattern in the input. So for instance, reverse that we defined before can be defined differently, can be reverse of nil is nil, reverse of the empty list is empty list. Else, reverse of a list that contains a head x and a tail xs is reverse of the tail xs, concat the list that contains x, the head of the list. So really what patterns are doing are defining possible inputs. If the input is empty, I already have the result. If the input has at least one head, how do I use that to compute the result? So these patterns are inspected in order as they were defined sequentially from top to bottom. And the first that matches the input basically says, oh yes, reverse of XXS matches the input because the input is a list that contains at least one head. That will be the function that will be called as basically that's the next, the value of the function will be by evaluating the expression to the right of that equal, okay? That's what definition by pattern is.
So is this essentially the equivalent of overloading methods in Java by any chance?
I never made that parallel, but I totally agree with you. Although in Java, what we are using is not the pattern of the input, we are using the type of the input. So if the type of the input is whatever matches that definition, then it uses that one. Here we are actually matching the input. We are saying that there are two possibilities for the first argument, being empty or being a list that contains at least one element, the head of the list and then the tail. So you're right, it's overloading. It's exactly overloading. We are basically saying that these are the possibilities, starts matching the input to every single pattern in order from top to bottom. And the first one that matches, it evaluates the expression. And then it does it recursively. So now exactly the same happens again. It tries to match the new call to the patterns one by one. And if it doesn't match, like this is the list that contains 2, 3, this is the empty list, they are not equal. So it just continues and says, oh, but I can take 2 out and cons the list that contains 3. And that basically calls again the next concat. But it is a very good example. It's an example of overloading.
Okay, but and I guess just a follow-up question. If, like, let's say you wanted to, is there a way to specify, since we touched upon there's a distinguishing factor between like real numbers and I think it was real numbers and integers in SML. Is there a way to specify that kind of type? No. Or is there like a limitation that you have?
That's a limitation of SML, that every function, it's defined on a single type. So in SML, we tried last time to write the same function for 2 different types. The second time we wrote it for reals, it overwrote the definition for integers. So you just cannot do it.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Okay. Definition by patterns. Okay. So remember that we had these examples of sets last lab, and we basically solve it using if statements. Member, for instance, takes an element and the list. If the list is empty, that the element cannot be in that list, so it returns false. Else, if the element is equal with the head of the list, we return true. There are 2 base cases. Else, since the list was not empty and X was not equal with the head, it could be possible that X is in the tail of that list. So it calls recursively member of X and the tail of the list. Now, if I have to define it by patterns, there are 2 possibilities for L, being the empty list or a list that contains a head and a tail. So that's exactly what we are doing here. The first pattern is member of X in the empty list is false. Otherwise, member of X in a list that has a head Y cons a tail YS is equal with, if X is equal with Y, then true, else call member on X and the tail YS. So basically we have a pattern, like we basically expect it, because there are 2 possible ways that the second argument is. And the first way is basically with the empty list. The second one is with at least 1 element. And in that case, if it's with at least 1 element, I have actually to do the comparison. I have to check if X is equal with Y and then return true. If it's true, otherwise call member of X in YS in the tail of that list. Now, in SML, it's not actually possible to use the same variable. So in SML, this is the only way that you can define it with patterns. But in Prolog, a logic programming language, you can use the same variable. So the same program, so let me actually write it in SML. So member of X in the empty list is equal with false, else member of X in YS. You can use any 2 variables in really head and tail if you want, is equal with, if X is equal with Y, then true, else member of X in YS. Now the same thing in Prolog would be member of X in the empty list is false. And in fact, you don't even have to write this rule, because in Prolog, you basically, everything has to be true or false. So you can basically omit this case, because if it's not true, then it's by default false. So this can be actually deleted, this case. And then you can basically just add that member of X in a list that contains a head and a tail is true if X is equal with a head. But instead of saying this X is equal with a head, you can just use the same variable here. So you can basically say that member of X in the list that starts with X is true. And then member of X in the list that starts with some element but is different than X and has a tail is true if member of X in the tail is true. Okay. So instead of basically having two variables and checking if they are equal and then return true, you can basically use the same variable. But this is only in Prolog, because Prolog actually stands for programming in logic. And it has this feature that you can basically use the same variable twice in the call of the function, in the definition head of the function, or the definition, I would say method signature, but it's not really method signature. These are relations in Prolog. Okay. But basically it's the same idea of using patterns, only that you can omit the patterns for which is false, and you can reuse variables in the head of the rule. Okay. I misspelled member. Okay. So that's what definition by patterns is. It's very simple, very straightforward. Instead of using if statements, you define what are the possible calls to this function. So one other thing, actually, let's discuss about union. So union, we also defined it last time, union of two sets represented as lists. If the first list is empty, then the second list is the result of the union. Else, if the head of the first list is a member of the second list, then I don't need to keep it in the union. I want to eliminate duplicates. So I return as the result the union between the tail of the first list and the second list. I ignore it. If it's not, then I have to keep it in the union. So I keep the head of the first list, cons the result of that union of the tail of the first list and the second list. If you want, you can write it as with pattern definitions. So the union of the empty list with another list is equal with that second list. Else, the union of a list that contains at least one element X and the tail XS is, and with a list L2. If X is a member in L2, if the head of the first list is a member in L2, I call union of the tail XS and L2. Else, I keep X because it's not a member, cons the union of XS and L2. So basically, it makes sure to eliminate duplicates when there are elements that are in the first list, but and also in the second list. Okay. So really, this is what definition by patterns is. Some people, it's a matter of personal preference if you want to use patterns or you want to do if statements. I personally like the first one, and that's how I write most of my programs. But you have to be aware of other ways to write the program using patterns. Intersection. We also discussed it last time. Given two lists, L1 and L2, if the list L1 is empty, that basically means that there is nothing in the intersection. There is nothing that is in both lists. Else, if the head of the first list is a member of the second list, then it's considered to be in the intersection. It's both in the first list as being the head of the first list, and in the second list because member succeeded. So the head of L1 is kept, cons the result of intersection of the tail of L1 and L2. So basically we keep the element, the first element, and then we call intersection on the rest of L1. Otherwise, if it was not a member of L2, then we don't keep it. It's not in the intersection. So I call directly intersection between the tail of L1 and L2. So really intersection is the elements that are in common. Again, if I want to write it with patterns, I can basically consider all possible patterns. Like for instance, if the intersection, the intersection between the empty list and another list is empty, I can also write a second case, the intersection of a list with the empty list is also empty. So this basically eliminates some extra work because we already see the second list is empty. Otherwise, it's the intersection between a list that contains a head and a tail and L2. If the head is a member of L2, then we keep it and we call the intersection of the tail and L2. Else, we just call the intersection of the tail access and L2. Okay? So that's the definition by patterns. Subset. We also discussed it last time in the lab. So subset L1 is considered to be a subset in L2. If L1 is empty, then it's true because empty is a subset of any other list, including empty list itself, in fact. If it was not the case that L1 was empty, on the else branch, if L2 is empty, then we have false immediately because a list that contains one element cannot be a subset of the empty list. No, basically, if we know that is not the empty list L1 and L2 is the empty list, this cannot be, L1 cannot be a subset of L2. So we return false on that branch. Otherwise, if the head of L1 is a member of L2, we call recursively subset of the tail of L1 and L2. Otherwise, it means that the head of L1 is not in L2, so it cannot be L1, it cannot be a subset of L2. It contains elements that are not in L2. So it returns false on that branch if the head of L1 is not a member of L2. And again, I have the subset definition. So the first definition basically says the empty set is a subset of any other set. L1 is a subset of empty if L1 is empty. But this is actually not necessary because the first pattern is the one that fires. So I know L1 cannot be empty. So I can just basically write this. I can say empty is a subset of any other set is true. If that was not the case, the first pattern to fire, then L1 subset L1 empty is equal with false. And this is because L1 cannot be empty because otherwise we would have captured that case in the first line. So basically a list that is not empty cannot be a subset of the empty list. So immediately we have that case. And then the only other case is when the first list is an element followed by a tail. But these are tested sequentially. So we got here in case that neither the first list nor the second list were empty. In that case, we actually have the check. If X is a member of L2, then we call subset of XS and L2. Otherwise, immediately we return false because basically it says the head of the first argument list is not in the second argument. So now this is the definition by patterns. Set equal is basically that L1 is a subset of L2 and also L2 is a subset of L1. So for instance, 157 is a subset of 5751 and vice versa. Therefore, set equal is equal. It's basically true. These two sets are the same because sets do not contain the order of elements. Set minus. So I have here the definition with patterns. Let me see. I don't have the definition without patterns. So let me actually copy this. So first I will give you the definition without patterns. Set difference minus between a list L1 and L2 is equal with if L1 is equal with empty, then empty, else if the head of L1 is a member of L2, then we call basically, it basically means I call minus between the tail of L1 and L2. Let's put it like this. Else I take the head out because I know that that is not in the second list. Actually is minus. So yeah, it's not in the second list, so I should keep it. Cons minus between the tail of L1 and L2. Okay. So this is the definition without patterns. And basically you see if I want the difference between 1579 and 23510, it takes the first element is one, a member of the second list is not. So it basically goes on the else branch and puts one in the result and then calls minus between the tail of the first list, which is 579, and this list. And then next element 5 is a member, so it doesn't keep it. It just calls minus of the rest of the list. Okay. And if you want to define it with patterns, then is this definition minus between the empty set and L2 is the empty set, or minus between a list that contains a head and the tail and L2 is if X is a member of XS. Of L2, then we call minus between the tail XS and L2, else we keep X, cons minus between the tail XS and L2. So this is basically the way to define minus with patterns. Cartesian product. So I don't know if you remember from last time, we basically said that the Cartesian product is the set of all the pairs where we take every element in the first set and we combine it with every element in the second set. So we get a set of tuples. And for that, I used a helper function, product one. So what product one was doing takes one element and the list, and I'm using here the pattern definition. Basically, if the list is empty, there are no pairs to be made with X and the elements in the empty list. Otherwise, it has to be the case that product one is invoked with one element X and the list that has a head and a tail. The head is Y and the tail is YS. And in that case, one of the pairs is XY, and that's cons to the result of product one of X and the tail YS. So really we take element by element and we group it with this first argument. So for instance, product one of 1 and 2, 3 is a set of tuples 1, 2, and 1, 3. That's basically the recursive call. So now the product per se, Cartesian product, it's also a recursive function. Product of the empty set and L2 is empty because there are no elements to be grouped from the first set. Otherwise, product between a list that has a head X and the tail XS and L2 is the union, set union that we defined before between the product one and of X and L2 and the product of XS and L2. So basically I break out one element at a time and I create all the tuples between that one element and the second list elements. The same thing can be written with if statements. And in fact, let me do it. So how to write this first statement with if statements? If basically the product one between x and the list. If the list is empty, then empty. Else, I basically return the tuple formed out of the out of x and the head of l and cons with the product one of x and the tail of l. Okay, so that's the first definition without patterns. Now the second definition, same thing, product between l1 and l2 is equal with, if l1 is empty, then l2. Else, okay. So else, call the union of product one of the head of L1 and L2 with the product of the tail of L1 and L2. So now we basically have the Cartesian product written with if statements. And the same thing basically with patterns. You have the product between x and the empty list is empty, or the product between y, x, and a list that contains y as the head and ys as the tail is the pair xy cons the product one of x and ys. So basically it creates all the tuples between that first element and every element in the second list, the second argument, that is a list. And product, Cartesian product between the empty set and L2 is empty, or the other possibility is the product between a list that contains at least one head, X and XS, in which case it does that union. But in fact, I can actually add another optimization here. I can also consider the case, okay, in which I'm calling product with between a list and the empty list. And that's also empty, no? So this is kind of like an optimization. By adding that one line, it eliminates the case where you basically go into one long list as the first argument, while the second argument is empty and you shouldn't have any pairs anyway. Okay. So that's another example of optimization, in fact. Power set. So this is a little bit more difficult. Okay. So let me explain to you first, how do I compute a power set? So can someone tell me what's the power set of a set? Like for instance, 1, 2, 3.
It's the set of all subsets.
Excellent. So if I want to enumerate all the subsets of this set, will be the empty set, the set that contains one, the set that contains two, the set that contains three, the set that contains one, two, the pairs basically, one, three, two, three, and one, two, three. Okay, but we don't have iteration. So the question is, what is the relationship between the power set of a set that contains some number of elements and the power set of the tail of that set? Okay. So first of all, we know what is the power set of 1, 2, 3. Michael, the power set of 2, 3, in the same way as all the subsets of 2, 3, is the empty set, the set that contains two, the set that contains three, and the set that contains two and three. So think for a little bit, what is the relation between this set and this set? Okay. Can you find a recursive case where you take the tail of the list, you compute a power set, and from that you can obtain, and at the head of the list, you can obtain the entire power set? Any idea?
It's the power set of the tail set.
Okay.
The union with the Cartesian product of one and the power set of the tail set.
Close. Instead of Cartesian product, because that will give us pairs, just insert into every element in the power set of the tail the first element.
Okay.
So I call that function insert all, insert in all the first element, the head, and into basically that power set of 2, 3. So what do I mean? Basically, I mean that take this list that was the power set of 2, 3. And insert in each one of them one. Because now if you take the power set of 2, 3, no, and you union it with the list that you obtained by inserting in each one of them one, you actually get exactly the power set of 1, 2, 3. So basically, we got the empty set is here. We got 2, it's here. We got 3, it's here. We got 2, 3, it's right here. Then we inserted 1 and we got basically the set contains 1. We inserted 1 in 2 and we got 1, 2. We inserted 1 in 3 and we got 1, 3. And we inserted 1 into 2, 3, and we got 1, 2, 3. So really the recursive formula is that the power set of a list that contains a head and a tail is the same with the power set of the tail union the insert into all the head of the original list into all of the power set of the tail. That's the recursive formula. That's basically that gives us, given the power set of the tail, we can get the power set of the head const tail by inserting in each one of those power sets the head and doing the union with the power set of the tail. So that's exactly what we basically, how do we compute the power set of a longer list from the power set of the tail and those insertions of the head into the elements of the power set of the tail. So now we have to implement it in SML. So basically first we need the helper functions like insert all, takes an element and the list. If the list is empty, it returns empty. Else, it puts the element in the head of the list because this is a list of lists, is the power set of the tail. So it puts E into the head of that list, the first element that is a list. Cons, the result of insert all of the element into the tail of that list. So really it's exactly this case. We want to insert 1 in the result of power set of 2, 3, which is the list that contains the empty list, the list that contains 2, the list that contains 3, and the list that contains 2 and 3. So we would get exactly this list. And this is a comment, by the way, in SML. So if you want to leave some code that actually is not executed, it's like you would have in Java forward slash star star forward slash. It's a command. So this is what you get as a result of calling the function above. Then the power set of a list. First, we have the base case. If the list is empty, then you return the list that contains the empty list is the list of all subsets of the empty list. So this is the base case. Else is the power set of the tail of the list concatenated with insert all of the head of the list in the power set of the tail of the list. So this is basically how you compute this power set. Any questions? Okay. You can actually write some of these functions using pattern definitions. So if you want with patterns, these same definitions can be simplified a little bit. So insert all E into the empty list is the empty list. Else, let me just write it like this. Else insert all and E into the list that contains Y cons YS is equal with E cons Y, everything cons, insert all of E in YS. Okay, that's basically it. If I make it a little bit smaller, I think it fits in the right hand side there. And similarly here, if you want to write this power set, the power set of the empty set is the set that contains the empty set. Else, power set of head cons tail is equal with the power set of the tail concatenated with the insert all of the head into the power set of the tail again. So this is the definition using patterns, but it's really the same definition. It's just that you considered all the possible inputs and you can simplify. You don't need to call anymore the tail function or the head function. Any questions? Okay. Next is the most interesting part of functional programming. In functional programming, you basically can use as parameters functions, and you get what is called higher level functions, higher order functions, or second order functions. So the first example that I want to give you is something that you actually saw when we did aggregates in Java collections. It's this map. So sorry about that. Map basically takes an argument, which is a function and a list, and applies that function of on every element of the list. So you basically will get a list as the result, but the list contains for every original element, the function applied to that element, okay? So if the list is empty, then the result of map is empty. Else, you apply the function on the head of the list, cons, the result of map of the same function on the tail of the list. So basically, if you take a function, so even you if you look at the result that SML returns, it basically says map takes as an input a function that maps elements from a domain A to a domain B, a list of elements in the domain A, and the result is a list of elements in the domain B. Because basically for every A in the original list, you are getting a corresponding B given this function that takes elements in A and gives you the value of that function in B, okay? So for instance, let's say that we have a square function defined. Square of X is X multiplied with X. This is for integers. So for X, it gives you the square of that X. So now map will take square and a list of elements like 2, 3, 4, and apply square to each one of them. So you basically get a list that contains the squares of those elements. So instead of 2, you have 4. Instead of 3, you have 9. Instead of 4, you have 16. So map takes a function and a list and returns the list of all of the values mapped by that function. So just to remind you, this is exactly what we talked about when we had aggregates. So map, basically here is an example. You get for a stream, for every element of the stream, call the toString method. So you get a stream of not original elements, but the toString results for every element. Okay, so that's exactly what we have, but now in SML, you have a higher order function. You take a collection like a list and a function, and you apply this function to every element from the head to all the elements up to the empty list. Okay. In fact, you can rewrite this function with, again, if you want, this function can be written as with basically patterns. So the function map, if you take a function and the empty list is just the empty list, else map of the function f and a head cons the tail is the function f applied to the head cons map of the function f applied to the tail. So it's a shorter definition, but really is the same thing that we had in the case of map above. It says apply f on the head, cons it with apply map of the function on the tail. Okay, that's what map is. It's a second order function that takes a function and a list. And similar to this, you can write other functions, like for instance, a function, let's say filter. So filter takes a function that is a Boolean function and a list. Let's say we define it with patterns. If you pass in the empty list, then you get the empty list. Else, if you apply filter on f on a list that contains a head and a tail, then you basically can write an if statement. If that function of the head is true, then you return head cons filter of the function f and the tail t. Else, you just return filter of the function f on the tail t, because basically, so this is a function that takes a Boolean function, like for instance, I have positive takes x and it returns true if x is greater than 0, and it returns false otherwise. So now if I do filter of positive and a list of elements like -1, 2, -4, 0, 5, 6, -7, let's say, this will basically return a list of the positive elements. So in this case, 2 is positive, 5 is positive, and 6 is positive. So it's basically a function that takes a Boolean function, a function where the codomain is Boolean, and it filters, given that filter function, a list of only the elements that for which that function was true. Okay, and we also saw that, if you remember, filter was right here. I want from the collection of geometric shapes only those shapes that are red. So it's again, it's an example of second order functions, functions that basically take other functions as parameters. Okay. Any questions? Okay. So that's basically higher order functions. And I have many examples that I want to cover for higher order functions, but I will do it next class. Today I want to go next over the lab. So basically I have two problems in today's lab. One problem to compute the minimum and the maximum elements from a list. So I call it min max. It takes a list of elements and it returns as a tuple the minimum and the maximum. And there are two ways to write this function, okay? So one way is to write it the way that I wrote it here, which I will explain in a couple of minutes, which computes both the min and the max into one single function, okay? The second way is to actually compute it separately, compute the min, compute the max, and return each one of them. So let me implement the second version first. So basically, I want to write a function that, given a list, it returns a pair. So this function is called min max. And the easiest is basically to return a pair, minimum of the list and maximum of the list. Okay. And then you can implement separately these functions. So the minimum of the list can be implemented straightforward as with a helper function. You can basically define minimum helper with two arguments, where the head of the list is the original minimum, the default minimum, and look in the rest of the list for other minimums. So now we can define min helper of function min helper of current minimum M and basically a list L. If the list L is empty, then M is the minimum. Otherwise, it basically has to compare the current minimum. If current minimum is less than the head of the list, then call minimum with the current minimum and the tail of the list L. Else, it basically means that the minimum is not M. So I call min helper or this min helper. Of the head of the list and the tail of the list. So basically this min helper starts with the head of the list considered to be the minimum, and then it finds the minimum in the rest of the list by comparing that with the next element. So I basically always compare with the next element in the list. And similarly, I can write max. So the function max calls a helper function. So this M takes a list and calls max helper of the head of the list and the tail of the list. And this max helper basically takes the maximum and the current list. If the list is empty, then it returns M as the maximum. Else, it compares if M is greater than the head of the list L. then it calls max helper of M and the tail of the list L, else it calls max helper of the head of the list L and the tail of the list L. So let's try all of these methods separately, and then basically we can put it together. So minimum, we defined it, and now we say, what's the minimum of 1, 2, 3, 4, 0? And it says it's 0. Okay, so it works. And similarly, we take max, we test it separately, and we ask, what's the maximum of 1, 2, 3, 4, 0? And it says 4, which it is maximum. So now min max, we pass a list, and we want both min and max. So now I'm asking, what's the min max of 1, 2, 3, 4, 0? And it says 0 and 4. 0 is the minimum, 4 is the maximum. Okay. So, but how can I compute these into a single function? And that's the beauty of this method. So basically, min max takes a list. If the list is empty, then it returns 0, 0. It's just a base case. Otherwise, it starts with considering that the minimum is the head of the list and the maximum is also the head of the list, and calls the helper method with the head of the list as both min and max and the rest of the list. Min max helper takes the current minimum and the current maximum and the list. If the list is empty, then it returns the pair min max. Otherwise, if the head of the list is less than the minimum, then that's the new minimum. So we call min max helper of the head of the list, the current maximum, and the tail of the list. And basically, similarly, if the maximum is less than the head of the list, then it calls min max helper of the current minimum, the head of the list that was greater than the max, the current maximum, and the tail of the list. If the head of the list is neither smaller than the minimum or bigger than the maximum, it's somewhere between min and max, so we leave it at ease. We call recursively min max helper between the min max as the current minimums and maximums and the tail of the list. So the advantage of this that is that everything that we did in five methods before, five functions before, one to compute the minimum with a helper, one to compute the maximum with a helper, we do it in two functions. So we do it in this recursive helper function, which takes the min and max and compares it with the current minimum, current maximum, and recursively computes the min max. And the main method, min max, that basically just calls min max of the head of the list as the current minimum and the current maximum and the tail of the list. Okay, those 314 Blackboard notifications are stressing me out. What 314 notifications?
Oh, I was just joking in the corner. It says that like the 314, as in like the little button you have in the corner. Okay.
Sorry about that.
You're a teacher. It's a completely different thing. It's like every time anyone inputs an assignment, but like in my brain, that's like 314 notifications or assignments past due. And I'm like, my heart rate is increasing just seeing.
I totally understand. Okay, good. Okay, and the second problem. Write an SML function that, given a list, finds the length of the longest sublist without repeating elements. So for instance, the longest sublist into this list without repeating elements is basically, if you look this list here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, is a list with no repeating elements. If we move one element to the left, it has repeating 2. If we move one element to the right, it has repeating 6. So basically, the longest sublist without repeating elements in this entire list, because you can basically look at any moment at any position, is this one. That is the longest sublist. So the question is, how can you write it recursively? How can you write an SML function that finds that longest sublist without repeating elements? So recursively, the idea is that you start from the beginning with the longest prefix without repeating elements. So basically, the longest sublist calls the longest prefix, which only finds one. Okay. And then you call the longest sublist for the rest of the list. So basically, it's really you're computing the maximum for this longest sublist between the longest prefix without repeating elements and the longest sublist of the tail of the original list. Because what that does, it's again looking from the beginning. So what you are doing is kind of like a sliding window. You start from the beginning and you look for the longest prefix that has no repeating elements. So from the beginning is just this one. Then it finds this one for the next one, because then two repeats. Then it finds these two. Then it finds 3, 2, 1. Then it finds 2, 1. Then it finds 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. Basically, it's like you start from every position and you find the longest prefix from that position with no repeating elements. So really I wrote exactly like that. I have the helper function member length that computes the length of a list, maximum between two integers, and then the two functions that are the main functions. The longest prefix with no repeating elements, which I will explain next, and the longest sublist, basically with no repeating elements. Let's start with the longest sublist. This one is straightforward. If the list is empty, then the longest sublist with no repeating elements is zero, has a length of zero. Then else, it computes the maximum between the length of the longest prefix with no repeating elements and the longest sublist in the tail. So the longest prefix starts from the beginning and finds the longest prefix, and I get the length of that. And the maximum between that and the result of what's the longest sublist with no repeating elements from the tail is actually the longest sublist for the entire list. Okay. And I have an example below, and then I will explain the longest prefix, this function here with no repeating elements. But look at this example. Longest sublist in our case is the maximum between the length of the longest prefix with no repeating elements, which is just length of the list that contains one, and the longest sublist starting from the second element. And that will call, again, the length of one is one, and now you get the longest sublist. And again, you do the same thing, is the maximum between the longest prefix. In our case, that was three, in this case, with no repeating elements, and the longest sublist of the rest. In fact, here I have a typo. This should start with two, because I already looked at 1, 2, 3 and so on. So this 1, 1 should not be here. It's a mistake. But basically this is the idea. And now the longest prefix with no repeating elements basically starts from the beginning. If the list is empty, then it returns just the prefix that I computed up to now. We start with empty as being that prefix when we call the method. Otherwise, it looks if the current head of the list is a member of the current prefix. If it was originally empty, it's not. Then it returns, if it is a member, then I'm done. This is the prefix that is the longest with no repeating elements. Otherwise, I call the longest prefix between the tail of the list L and the head of the list L cons the longest prefix. So basically, I put at the beginning the head of the list, because I know that is not an element in the prefix, so I can continue to find the longest prefix. Okay, so really what basically is happening, it's like a sliding window from the beginning to the end, and it finds for every position the longest prefix, and it puts it in this max, the length of that prefix, it puts it in this max. So for this case, the longest prefix with no repeating elements will be obtained when we reach to this list that starts with one, and it finds the longest prefix with no repeating elements being of six. And at that moment, the max between whatever was before and six will give you six. And that's basically it. Okay. So this is the lab that I want you to experiment with. And if you have a better solution, please let me know. Okay, that's basically it for today. Next class will continue from here with other higher order functions. And I will explain to you some of the functions that we discussed in class when we talked about Java collections. For instance, we had this function of reduce in Java collections or collect in Java collections. I will also show you how to do numerical integration, collect like in Java streams, as I said, average and so on. These are all basically ways to write higher order functions. So that's all for today. We'll continue from here next class. Any questions? If not, that's it. Thank you very much.